Hello, I'm Dr. Eddy Ameen, and I manage the American Psychological Association's offices on early career psychologists and graduate students. Thank you for joining us today. This is APA Journal's Dialogue. It's a podcast featuring research from early career psychologists that are published by the American Psychological Association's Journals program. Today's episode will highlight the September 2019 special issue of the journal Clinical Practice in Pediatric Psychology. It's the official publication of Division 54, and the Clinical Practice in Pediatric Psychology Journal is also known as CPPP. It publishes articles representing the professional and applied activities of pediatric psychology. In this special issue, guest editor Diane Chen and colleagues will offer new perspectives in advancing the practice of pediatric psychology with transgender youth. So here with us to discuss her research is Dr. Diane Chen. She's Behavioral Health Director for the Family Division of Adolescent and Young Adult Medicine at the Anne and Robert H. Lurie Children's Hospital of Chicago. Diane, we're so pleased to have you, and thanks very much for joining us today.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
I want to start with a global question. I know you worked very hard on the special issue and made a hugely important contribution to psychological science. For those of us that are listening and wonder a little bit about the work that you do, can you speak to that, the clinical and research work you do with trans and gender diverse youth?
Absolutely. So I am a clinical child and pediatric psychologist by training. And at Lurie Children's, I work exclusively with a multidisciplinary subspecialty team that provides direct clinical care to youth and families seen within our gender and sex development program. This program was founded in 2013 and includes a really diverse team of clinicians that includes psychologists, psychiatric social workers, adolescent medicine physicians, and an advanced practice nurse, as well as pediatric endocrinologists. And as a team, we care for transgender, gender expansive, and gender questioning children, adolescents, and young adults and their families. We provide primary care, medical care for gender affirmation, such as pubertal suppression treatment and gender-affirming hormones, and behavioral health care. And so we offer twice-monthly integrated gender health clinics where youth and families are seen jointly by our medical and behavioral health clinicians simultaneously. And youth and families are also seen by our psychologists and psychiatric social workers outside of that integrated clinic for assessment and therapy services. Since we officially opened our doors in 2013, we've cared for more than 1,200 transgender and gender expansive youth in the Chicagoland area. In terms of research, our Lurie Children's team is engaged in two multi-site longitudinal studies with our collaborators at Children's Hospital Los Angeles, UCSF, Benioff Children's Hospital, and Boston Children's Hospital. One study examines the physiologic and psychosocial outcomes of early medical treatment for gender dysphoria in two cohorts of transgender youth. The first cohort are youth who are in the early stages of puberty, who are seeking pubertal suppression treatment. And the second cohort are youth coming to us in the later stages of puberty who are seeking gender-affirming testosterone or estrogen treatment. We also have a second multi-site study with those same collaborators where we're recruiting a third cohort of younger gender-expansive children who have not yet reached puberty with the goal of examining gender development and mental health functioning over time. We're also particularly interested in looking at how social gender transition might impact mental health functioning in these children. In addition to these two multi-site studies, I'm also working on a project to develop a fertility-related decision aid for transgender adolescents and their and young adults. The finished product will hopefully guide patient education about fertility and family planning and support youth and their families in making complex decisions about fertility preservation options like sperm or egg banking.
You are doing some tremendous and cutting-edge work. How did you find yourself in an interdisciplinary clinic for trans and gender-expansive youth?
Well, you know, it really was sort of a right place, right time type of situation. You know, as I was coming out of fellowship training at Lurie Children's, that was when the hospital received philanthropic funding to start this clinic. And so I really consider it a right place, right time type of situation for myself. And it's been really rewarding work.
And you get a lot of research time in your position?
I do. You know, I think I'm really lucky. The position that I was offered coming out of fellowship was 3 years of 50% protected research time. And I know that's a little bit unheard of in academic medicine. So I definitely jumped at that. And so over the last 6 years, you know, I've been mentored really well, and I think I've been really successful at obtaining external funding. And at this point, I'm about 70% funded to do research.
The clinic itself, can you give me a sense of the age ranges and how far are clients coming to receive services at the Children's Hospital of Chicago?
Yeah. You know, the only criteria that we have for initiating care in our clinic is really age. And so we will see young people up until their 25th birthday. Otherwise, we don't have any other requirements that they have, you know, seen an outside mental health provider who's making a referral. Families can be self-referred. So I would say, you know, we have seen youth as young as 3 all the way up until their 25th birthday. But I would say the majority of young people that we care for are school age and adolescents.
So you describe working with children and youth from ages 3 and up. At what age does somebody begin to know whether they're a boy or a girl?
Gender identity development, which is like the child development literature, would point to, you know, youth typically having a good understanding of themselves as a boy or as a girl, typically by school entry. So typically by the age of 5 or so, you know, children typically develop a sense of gender of themselves. And that for most youth, that gender is going to sort of stay consistent throughout their lifetime. But for younger kids, like you asked, like 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds, whatnot, you know, how do we know? Well, more often than not for these younger youth, it's not related to necessarily what they're saying, but how they are acting or that their types of preferences. And I'm always really careful in working with parents of younger children that they don't equate gender expression or the way that they play, the clothes that they prefer, the gender of playmates that they seem to sort of identify more with, that those behavioral preferences are not always, that they're not equal to gender identity, right? So just because a little boy likes playing dress up or is friends with mostly girls does not mean that that little boy identifies as a girl. Now, I certainly have seen clinically, you know, and parents have reported that, you know, that their very young children have sometimes had very extreme behavioral reactions to, say, being put into a dress, for example. So like girls, you know, little girls being put into a dress where they would become distraught, rip the dress off. They have tried to cut their own hair to kind of cut their hair short. So through sort of actions, behavioral actions that way, that might suggest that they're distressed or uncomfortable with being perceived as a boy or as a girl. I have heard narratives from families that, you know, that the child's early on of the child's like first words, you know, for a little boy were like, me, girl, you know? And so again, I think it's really hard to say, but I would say, you know, when we think about gender development, if you think about a cisgender, a non-transgender child, a 3-year-old can tell you if they're a boy or a girl, and if they're cisgender, or if what they say coincides with the sex that they were assigned at birth or what we expect as adults, we typically don't question that. Right. So we question the kids who say, I'm a boy, but you know that they were assigned female at birth, right? Those are the kids that we question. So I would say that.
Can you give us a sense of some of the questions that you, the team, the youth, and perhaps their families wrestle with?
Absolutely. You know, I think that with the younger children, I think a big question that is out there is related to, you know, what is the likelihood that my child who is asserting an identity that may not align with their sex assigned at birth, how likely is that identity to sort of persist through adolescence and adulthood, the degree to which a transgender identity is sort of consistent and persistent over time. I think that's a really common question that we get. As we think about older youth, as youth are presenting for medical treatments, so whether that is pubertal suppression or gender-affirming hormones, I think a lot of the questions center around the safety of these medications and what do we know about the long-term impact impacts on health, on physical health, of these medical treatments that now are more and more accepted as standard of care. Because the truth of the matter is that we don't have a lot of really long-term outcome studies, looking at hormonal interventions in trans adolescents that are given these treatments in adolescence and following them through adulthood and through sort of aging. We just don't have that research yet.
Given these really complex and interesting questions that you are privy to as a psychologist in the clinical space, I wonder, how did that inform the research projects that you're undertaking right now?
I think the research topics that I have chosen to pursue, that has always been informed by my clinical work. And I think the questions that are brought to me by transgender youth themselves and their families in the context of the clinical care that they receive. Sort of across the country, we are seeing increasing numbers of transgender and gender expansive young people coming forward seeking medical and mental health care. And there really is this limited evidence base informing the care that we provide. And so that's why some of the key questions from our studies are so important. Like, we need to document the safety and the risks of medical treatment for gender affirmation and the impact of these treatments on mental health and well-being. And that information is really going to be critical for youth and their families to make informed decisions about medical care that weighs the benefits and the risks of treatment to the potential risks of non-treatment.
Right. So thanks, Diane, for taking a moment to explain some of those things that are passionate for you. And I think you're in an amazing position to have sat at the helm of a special issue, advancing the practice of pediatric psychology with transgender youth. For those that are listening and may have been more on the receiving end of editorial feedback and have never sat in an editor's chair, if you could put that hat on for a second and tell us what that trajectory might look like. If somebody says, one day I have a topic I'd like to advance through a special issue, how would they get there?
Yeah, that's a great question. And I actually have to give a lot of the credit for this special issue to one of my co-guest editors, Dr. Terry Stanson. At the April 2017 meeting of the Society of Pediatric Psychology, our team of guest editors, so Dr. Terry Stanson, Dr. Edwards Leeper, Dr. Tishelman, and myself, we presented a workshop on ethical considerations in transgender healthcare. This session was really well attended by the conference attendees. And I think that really spoke to the interest that pediatric psychologists have in this underserved population of youth. And so Terry took the initiative to reach out to the editor-in-chief of Clinical Practice in Pediatric Psychology, Dr. Jennifer Sherman, and pitched the idea for this special issue on trans youth. And we were just thrilled that Dr. Sherman was so supportive of our team and of this topic from the beginning. In terms of actually putting together the special issue from beginning to end, it probably took about 2 years. Dr. Sherman invited us to contribute a commentary to Clinical Practice in Pediatric Psychology, where we reviewed the state of the science and identified ongoing controversies in gender healthcare that are particularly relevant to pediatric psychologists. And we ended that commentary with a call for papers for this special issue. We were surprised and just really excited about the response to our call for papers. We had 28 letters of intent submitted for consideration. We invited 18 authorship teams to submit full manuscripts. And ultimately, the special issue featured 10 papers. It took about 6 months for all the manuscripts to go through the peer review process. And there were definitely some long calls amongst our guest editor team to talk through some of the difficult decisions about which manuscripts to include. But overall, it was a lot of fun to see the special issue come together. And I'm really proud of our final product.
I can only begin to imagine the hours that you spent deliberating between those 18 manuscripts to narrow it down to 10. I see here in your introduction, if I may read, you say, mm-hmm. We were particularly interested in data-driven quantitative and qualitative studies that can inform clinical approaches to care for TGD or trans and gender diverse youth and mm-hmm. or resolve ongoing controversies most relevant to the roles of pediatric psychologists in gender affirmative care. You're also open to important commentaries or descriptions of programmatic or ethical innovations related to or relevant to excellence in care for TGD pediatric populations. That's quite an expansive list of topics that one might cover. And so this leads to the question, what was the significance of this special issue? Why now?
Well, so I think there's been a really big change in how we approach clinical care for transgender youth just in the last decade. And, you know, and we talk about it in the commentary where there really has been the sea change toward affirming youth in their identities and really taking youth, taking their word for their experience, right? And following their lead. And so really, what we were looking to do was to feature data-driven papers that had direct clinical implications for psychologists working with trans youth that could really move the needle forward in terms of providing an evidence base for the clinical care and the new sort of the new way that we're approaching care for trans youth. And I think we were successful in doing that.
I'll say, you say also in your introduction, along these same lines that you're providing data-driven evidence, quote, it is clear that psychologists want to move forward away from our historical role as gatekeepers to assisting trans and gender diverse youth in accessing, affirming, and sometimes life-saving medical and surgical treatment within the context of safety and support. This idea of gatekeeping is not without history and controversy. So I want to just ask you to think about the role of a researcher here, a clinically informed researcher. How did you begin to wrestle this historic question of gatekeeping through the special issue?
Yeah, so I think it really was around trying to move psychologists and the role of psychologists in clinical care sort of past that and think about the diverse roles that psychologists can play beyond assessment, right? Beyond the assessment of, is this one young person ready? Are they appropriate to receive medical treatment? Because I think when we think about psychological health and when we think about promoting wellness holistically, you know, there are so many other roles for, you know, for psychologists in promoting that, you know, within trans youth and families. And so, you know, for instance, you know, in our special issue, we feature a couple articles that focus on the role of parent and sibling support and acceptance as they relate to mental health functioning. And that is a really key role for psychologists sort of beyond assessment in being able to work with families to foster understanding and foster sort of supportive relationships within the family unit to support trans young people.
Our graduate student office here at the American Psychological Association recently published a guide for faculty to support trans and gender diverse graduate students. And it wasn't without some controversy when our release of that resource guide was picked up by a couple of media outlets. I'm wondering if in your research, have you ever had to defend what you're doing against folks that only see the gender binary?
Absolutely. And I actually think that doing this work, doing research, you know, with trans youth, I think it is always controversial, you know, and I think you feel the tension on both sides, you know, and I think as a psychologist, going back to what you had asked earlier regarding the history of gatekeeping, I think as a psychologist, there's like a push-pull, right, of you know, affirming medical providers, sometimes viewing psychology practice or mental health providers as, you know, as gatekeepers, right? And then on the flip side, I think sometimes, as you say, the public, the sort of public response to gender affirming care and I think misconceptions about what gender affirming care is, and thinking that gender affirming care means that, you know, young people get hormones on demand, which is not what gender affirming care is or how it you know, sort of moves forward in practice.
Right. And I appreciate then that this special issue takes on some of those myths and really kind of provides different pathways for clinicians.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm wondering if you could give us a flavor of some of the surprising findings or key takeaways that your articles helped uncover.
Sure. I think one of the most exciting papers in the special issue is an article by Luke Allen and colleagues showing that suicidality decreased and overall well-being improved among transgender adolescents after gender-affirming hormone treatment. This is the first study of psychological outcomes of medical treatment for gender affirmation based on a sample of adolescents drawn from the United States. It's also the first study that is able to disentangle the effects of gender-affirming hormone treatment on psychosocial functioning separately from any impact of gender-affirming surgical procedures in adolescents. So that was, I think, one of the most exciting papers that we feature. Another, I think, really important finding comes from Christina Olson's team. And her team looked at family discussions about childhood social transitions. There's a lot of controversy in the field surrounding childhood social transitions. And for those who may not be aware of what that means, you know, social transition refers to the process by which someone moves forward with living in their affirmed gender role, and may include things like choosing a name or gender pronouns that more align with their gender identity than their sex assigned at birth. And so, again, there's some controversy about whether or not talking to a child about social transition could possibly push them down the path of transitioning. And so Christina Olson's study engaged parents of both socially transitioned children, as well as parents of gender nonconforming children who were not socially transitioned. And what the authors found was that families of both subgroups were openly discussing the possibility of their children transitioning. And among children who had already initiated a social transition, the possibility of retransitioning at some point in the future. And yet what they found was that these discussions alone do not inevitably lead to the child making a social transition. And so really, you know, here, I think the take home is that children are leading the way, and that discussing social transition alone is not leading kids down this path that I think, folks are concerned about, and that we see out in the media. And then I think the last paper I'll briefly highlight is the one by Emily Parisot and colleagues that explored family acceptance and rejection across family members. One of the most robust findings in the literature is that transgender and gender expansive youth who are supported by their parents do better from a mental health standpoint, whereas those who are rejected by parents are at increased risk for depression, anxiety, and suicidality. And so this study extends those findings by showing that sibling rejection also predicts increased suicidal ideation, which really emphasizes the importance of assessing acceptance and rejection across family members and working with all family members clinically to foster supportive relationships in the home.
Diane, I appreciate you taking the time to highlight some of these really interesting and in some cases groundbreaking research studies. The Olson article, the middle one that you mentioned, talks about social transitions and the fears that this study helped alleviate, in which if we start talking about gender diversity with children, that will make somebody trans or gender nonconforming. It has echoes to me of when we used to fear talking about or featuring, for example, a gay character on a TV program that a child might watch because it could make that child gay. All right. Did any of that ring a bell when you were reading over this research?
Yeah, and I think beyond that parallel that you make, I also see a parallel with sort of social fears or concerns that that sort of sexual health education that talks about safe sex practices, you know, might lead an adolescent who wouldn't otherwise, you know, engage in sexual activity, right? So I think, you know, we see echoes there. But again, I think there's nothing in the research that grounds those fears, right? That exposure to gay youth or exposure to gender diversity is going to promote someone, to sort of claim that identity as their own.
Right. So my follow-up question is, I mean, both the second and the third study that you highlighted offer something or some things for family treatment. And I wonder, for the psychologist reading these articles, or at least hearing about them on the podcast today, how does social transition research or even sibling rejection research make us better practitioners?
Yeah, so, you know, I think when when we think about social transition as a clinician, if I'm working with a family that is considering moving forward with a social transition, or a young person who's considering moving forward with a social transition, you know, I think it's really important to talk about how that transition affects not just that young person, but the family members as well. You know, I think there are really important sort of clinical discussions that need to occur in terms of, you know, what is the timeline for this? What do you want this to look like in the school setting? You know, social transition is not like flipping a light switch. It's not like, you know, one day you go to bed with one name and pronoun and one way of expressing your gender, and then, you know, you flip the switch and the next day you wake up a different person. You know, more often than not, it's a really gradual process where a young person may try on, a name or pronouns in certain contexts, somewhere where it's safe, maybe at home, and sort of see how it feels. See, do they feel good about that? And then sort of progressively expanding the spaces and places where they present in their authentic gender. And again, I think when we're talking about a family context, a social transition affects everyone in that family. It affects the way that parents or siblings may relate to the transitioning child, right? A brother becomes a sister, or vice versa. And there are questions that come up from peers of that sibling that I think, you know, also require attention in the therapy room. So again, you know, I think when we're talking about children moving forward with a social transition, it's just very important to bring the whole family together and talk about what that looks like for that family, and how does the child who's transitioning want their family members to support them in cases of non-affirmation? Do they want their sibling or parent to sort of jump in and correct folks if they're using the wrong pronoun, for example?
You've taken us quite a ways just through these collection of 10 articles towards more accepting and affirming healthcare for trans youth. What is next? What research, if you could wave a wand, do you wish was happening? Or and I know that you've also spent a lot of time in the treatment room. So my follow-up question to that is very much related. Where do you hope that the clinical care will advance?
Mm-hmm. I think those are great questions. And for me, the answers are sort of going to dovetail really nicely. So, you know, I think the mental health disparities experienced by transgender youth are just really well documented in the literature. And as seen from like the Allen paper and the special issue, there absolutely are mental health benefits to gender-affirming hormone treatment. And, you know, that said, I do think there's some misconception about gender-affirming care-centering medical treatment for gender affirmation, and the belief that medical transition alone is going to be sufficient to meet all of the mental health needs of transgender youth. And I think for those of us that care for these youth, we know that that's just not the case. And in terms of where we're at now, I think we're at a point where we understand that these mental health disparities that we see in transgender youth are driven, at least in part, by exposure to minority stressors, similar to what we see in other marginalized populations. And so I really do think it's critical to consider how minority stress theory can inform and be incorporated into existing evidence-based interventions that may be able to be delivered alongside gender-affirming medical treatment for youth who may need additional therapeutic support on top of a medical gender transition. And so I think that's both key clinically as well as, you know, from a research perspective.
Right. So I'm thinking about this gatekeeping model that you opened your special issue by naming, and mm-hmm. You're right. In some ways, I'm checking my own bias too. I see the psychologist coming in, providing clearance for the medical team, mm-hmm. and then stepping aside. But you're saying that's just chapter one.
Yeah, and what I'm saying is that we shouldn't even necessarily be providing medical clearance, right? And I think, you know, our model, the Lurie Children's model of care, does include an assessment or an evaluation or meeting with a mental health provider, and to sort of talk through a young person's understanding of their gender identity, exploring sort of their desires for transition, and assessing the young person's understanding of the medical or surgical intervention that they're desiring. And, you know, and do they have appropriate appropriate expectations for what that medical treatment may provide. You know, I think that's certainly part of what we do. But I think to leave it at that, I think we're really missing out on, you know, areas of expertise that we as psychologists have that we could really kind of build up and improve wellness in this community. You know, I think we have great existing evidence-based psychological treatments for depression and anxiety, which we know are, you know, conditions that are elevated in transgender youth. What we don't know is how helpful are our existing treatments, you know, delivered as is to trans youth? You know, are there aspects of those treatments that need to be adapted? You know, and I think if we're thinking about principles of community-based participatory research, we really need to partner with the transgender community to kind of take a look at our psychological treatments and help us sort of tease out what works and what doesn't work, what doesn't resonate with their experience, and to use that lived experience in helping us sort of adapt our treatments to meet the needs of this population.
Well, I want to thank you for showing up to do this research. I serve in DC on a task force to help improve our LGBT health disparities report that will come out every 2 years. And what we realize is that we just don't have good data on gender diverse and trans young people, or let alone across the age spectrum. Mm-hmm. I'm glad that you called attention to this and helped some of that data come to light. I wonder, you know, so wearing my APA hat, I'm very interested in how early career psychologists are taking the field in new and exciting directions, and how ECPs essentially are preparing the field for what's coming next. The colleagues in this space in which you work are early career psychologists, I wonder, or do you?
Yeah. So, you know, I think there's a range for sure, but very much, I think, dominated by early career psychologists. And what I'm noticing is that I am getting a lot more email inquiries from current grad students that are looking at Lurie as a potential internship site, for example. You know, and for the first time, I've been able to offer a 2-year postdoctoral fellowship, actually, you know, focused on gender health. That's 50% research and 50% clinical, and took my first fellow in August. So I definitely think that there is, you know, I think an increasing awareness and interest from early career psychologists and trainees in sort of meeting this need. And I think, like, in part, early career psychologists themselves are more likely to be members of the transgender community. And as I've mentioned before, I think sort of bringing the lived experience into the research process, into our clinical work, is going to be really critical to providing sort of culturally competent care moving forward.
Right. You've discussed your special issue and the role of clinicians and researchers working with trans and gender diverse youth really nicely. I wonder if you could just spend a few moments letting me know if there's any broader themes as a researcher that you think early career psychologists are going to have to face.
So I think the biggest issue for clinical researchers is going to be to address that science to practice lag time, you know, and I think, I'm not sure, but I think it takes something like 17 years for research evidence to reach and actually be reflected in clinical practice.
Wow, so, 17 yeah, years.
Yeah, don't quote me, but I'm pretty sure that's right. But I do think that, like, an eye toward dissemination and implementation is always going to be important early on in the research process. And again, I think it speaks to engaging, or the importance of engaging, the population that's the focus of your research in the research process to sort of facilitate the implementation aspect of your work. I actually think that social media can actually be really helpful in facilitating dissemination and implementation efforts, both in terms of communicating science directly to the public, as well as potentially engaging legislators and decision makers directly about translating your research findings to policy change. And I think it's probably not a coincidence that many of the most active research psychologists that I see on Twitter are implementation scientists themselves.
How do we bridge the gap as well from research to policy?
Yeah, I think that as grad students or during training, I know I did not receive any training on how to communicate my research findings with the lay public. And I think that's really important. And I don't know if that's something that is changing in clinical training these days. You know, in graduate school, like I was taught one way to communicate research findings, and that was to other members of the scientific community. And I think that as we think sort of more broadly about the reach of our work and the ability of our research to affect positive change, it becomes just really critical to develop that skill set to communicate directly with communities that our research is intended to impact and to the people who are in positions of power, like you said, to implement that policy change.
Right. It's sort of that saying that if you can't explain it so that your grandmother would understand it, you haven't quite explained it well enough.
Exactly.
And I know that there's a lot more work to do. So is there any call to action that you have for emerging researchers and leaders in this space that you're working?
Okay, so I think it's really important that as researchers and clinicians that we're not working in silos when we think about, you know, working with trans and gender diverse youth. There are many of us around the country that are doing this work. And I think in situations like this where we don't have a lot of research guiding clinical practice, it's more and more important to sort of connect with other people that are also doing this work. I see some steps forward for sure in this realm. Division 54, the Society of Pediatric Psychology, recently pulled together a gender health SIG. And I think that there is something like 15 to 20 psychologists that are already part of that group that was just pulled together. So I think it's in collaboration with other folks that are doing this work and also training the next generation of pediatric psychologists to be culturally competent to work with trans populations.
I can imagine there's somebody somewhere listening to this podcast who's about to begin a graduate career in psychology and is really interested in one day applying to work for you. So if your application numbers go up, you can thank the investment and time that you put into this issue and this podcast today.
Well, thank you so much for having me.
Really glad that you joined us. This is Dr. Diane Chen speaking about the special issue in clinical practice in pediatric psychology, an APA publication. Before we go, I want to remind you that we want to hear from you. Please consider giving us a rating on iTunes. It's the easiest way that you can leave us feedback, and it really helps. APA Journals Dialogue is part of the APA Podcast Network, and that includes other informative podcasts like Speaking of Psychology, highlighting some of the latest psychological research, as well as Progress Notes, which is about the practice of psychology. You can find all of these podcasts on iTunes or Stitcher or Spotify or wherever you get your podcasts. I'm Eddy Ameen with the American Psychological Association. Take care.